Thanks to everyone for coming today. We're excited to have you here. My name is Georgia Lucas, and I'm one of the COPSI co-chairs, the Committee on Scholarly Interactions. My other co-chair, Wen, will be coming in soon. He's just giving a lab presentation today, so he's sad to not be here, but we'll be here soon. I'm excited. So we're excited today to have a guest speaker that will be talking, that will have a lecture, and she is going to make this interactive, so is looking to engage you guys and ask questions. So please feel free to ask as many questions you like. I'd like to make this a lively discussion. But first, to introduce Dr. Albert, I'd like to introduce Neil Shaw, who is an associate housemaster here at City Pacific. He's been here for about 1.5 years, and is also a member at Harvard School of Business.
All right. Okay, well, I'm really excited to have the privilege of introducing Dr. Albright for the last COSI lecture of this academic year, for a lot of reasons, but I mean, I think at MIT we're used to having people around with these extraordinary records of achievement. To say that Dr. Albright has extraordinary record of achievement is probably an understatement, mostly because when you Google her, one of the first hits is a website called achievement.org. I'm sure you know about this, but there's a video where, you know, she talks about some of the extraordinary things that she's done, and it's on the side, it says, if you're interested in Dr. Albright, you may want to also watch the video with Jonas Salk, the inventor of the polio vaccine, or Francis Ford Coppola, like the greatest filmmaker of all time. So you're in good company, Dr. Albright. So there are many things that you could probably say about Dr. Albright, but she has many claims to fame. One of them is that she started skating at the age of 9. I understand that at some point early on in your skating career, you contracted polio, and then couldn't use your legs. And as part of the recovery process, you sort of powered through, not only started skating again, but went on to win multiple Olympic medals for figure skating. Became the first American ever to win a gold medal in this sport in 1956. There's this great interview with you somewhere where you say that, oh, it's a Boston Globe, where you say that when you're growing up, you're the only person you knew named Tenley. And then, you know, in 1956, after she won the gold medal, there were all these Tenleys all of a sudden all over the world. And I think it was this summer, you threw a bash for all the Tenleys all over the world. That's how cool she is.
There were 66 of them.
There's 66 Tenleys from around the world who came. And there's a great picture in the Globe. So, 1956, you retired from figure skating. So what do you do then? Well, if you're Tenley Albright, you go to Harvard Medical School. And at the time, was one of very, very few women at the medical school. We were talking about how, of all of the medical professions, to this day, surgery still is not necessarily the most friendly towards women, but back then I can't even imagine. Powered through, chose one of the most difficult, a surgeon myself, as to this, one of the most difficult specialties. Was on the faculty at Harvard Medical School. And then over the course of her career, not only served many, many patients, but some of the most important and enduring institutions in our country sought her wisdom as a board member and as a chairwoman, from the National Library of Medicine to the White House Fellowship, Whitehead Institute. Just learned about that one too. It's a long list. Then finally, although she got her formal education at Harvard, she found her way over to the better part of Cambridge more recently, and is now in charge of the MIT collaboration initiatives, where she helps bring systems-based approaches to deeply rooted social issues, including healthcare. So without further ado, one of the most inspiring people on earth, Dr. Tenley Albright.
But it's so nice to be here. I look forward to it, and I'm so glad to see all of you. And one of the things that makes me really excited about being here is having experts in so many different fields all together at once is actually what MIT Collaborative Initiatives is all about, and is really why I started MIT Collaborative Initiatives. So it's quite an experience to see all of you here. And I find myself wanting to get to know each one of you and wanting to hear about what you do. And I guess we'd have to be very, very interactive to get all of that done. But I hope that I can ask you questions and you can ask me questions too. And it is impressive to think that Georgia and Wynn are in charge of the scholarly things that go on here. And to see everybody here, knowing that you all have different backgrounds, but then you're pulled together by being chosen as presidential fellows, that's another very interesting thing to me too. And how many of you went to undergraduate school here?
You
not everybody.
Your team.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting. And how many of you are from this part of the country or from far away? Anybody? How many are from Massachusetts? Well, that's just a few. Mm-hmm. So getting you together in itself is a collaboration. I say that getting people together who are experts in different fields was important to me. And maybe I should go back and say the reason I was anxious to be here and to be able to work in collaboration was as a surgeon. Yes, we collaborate when we're in the OR, but it's quite an individual sport, really. And it just seemed to me that every time we're there, could we have gotten here earlier, or could we have prevented needing to have the surgery? So how can we do something about that? And at the same time, even at the Quadrangle at Harvard Medical School, I was very aware that anyone who was across the street had no idea what was happening at the medical school or in the Quadrangle. And people in the next building to each other or in the next lab to each other didn't have any idea what was happening. So it seemed to me that very often in research, I don't know if you find this too, but no matter how expert somebody is, there tends to reach almost a plateau many, many times, where if you could just get some other push to reach the solution. And it seemed to me if we could learn from what other experts were doing, whether it was in business or just some other field in science or in medicine, or something that had nothing to do with our particular field, maybe it would give it a new perspective and there'd be a thought, well, why is it you do it that way? When my company does this, we tend to look at it this way. So in a sense, it's almost like breaking the roadblock. And another thing, I became very aware that in medicine, we very often in research drill deeper and deeper and more microscopically. And so it seemed to me if we could look at the whole thing from a more broad perspective, would we find something else? So started putting some people together. Actually did a meeting at Harvard, and it was hosted by the business school. And we had, we sort of personally invited experts from all the different aspects of the university. We called the meeting Experimentation in Major Thinking and Transforming the Life Sciences. Well, the experimentation was having the meeting, and the other thing was looking at it in such a way that it was across the whole university, and so the day was the experiment and the transformation was to be hoped for. So after that meeting, people came up to me and said, oh, I'm so glad I came. Actually, people who had been at Harvard Medical School for years, they said, I've never been over to the business school. And somebody else said, well, oh, I'm so glad I came. This was an epiphany for me. I had no idea. I've seen people from other fields. And I thought, well, this doesn't make sense, because in a way, we all collaborate in some level, and maybe we could do it more. So we thought that, all right, why don't we put together a meeting and sort of look at healthcare? And we're looking at the healthcare system. And I remember one person getting up and saying, Well, you know, it's not a broken system, it's not a system. So then we thought, well, how do we study that? And how do we look at a system and try to approach getting it to be a system? And the group at a rather large meeting, we all were saying, okay, well, how about if, to look at it as a system, we pick a time-sensitive illness. By the way, I put a big watch on, so I'm trying to keep track of time. And we thought acute ischemic stroke would be a good example. If we looked at long before stroke happened, followed the life cycle up to the stroke, during what happened to the stroke, and then all the way until the end of life, maybe we could use that as an example, learning how to look at the whole system. So to do that, we chose an architect at the Harvard School, Graduate School of Architecture and Design, and because they do know how to look at the whole system. And it seemed to make sense to me, because of course we had other physicians involved, and we, when we have a project, we tend to have a group of, you might say, high-level advisors that we don't bother very much, but they're there to turn to, and then we have other advisors who are the topic experts. And so having chosen the architect seemed to make a lot of sense. We've had other advisors like the head of GE Healthcare and the former Prime Minister of Finland and Donna Shalala. There's a lot of interesting people like that. So as we looked at it, we found a lot of things made sense. One afternoon, however, the architect was called in by his chair, the chair of his department. She said, I need to see you in my office at 3 o'clock. So he went, he thought, oh, what have I done? And she said, why in the world are you doing a project on healthcare? And so he had a lot of explaining to do, but I think he finally let her know that why it was happening. And really our philosophy was, if we can pick somebody who purposely doesn't know much about the subject, then they can ask questions that we who are supposed to know about it might not think to ask. And so he traveled all over, and I remember one time in Texas, he was seeing the chief of neurology, and the neurology hearing was an architect, and he said, we've just gone over the lobby, how do you like our chairs? And so he had explained to do there, but he did everything. He flew on helicopters, he rode in ambulances, and found, much to his surprise, that when he was questioning some of these stroke experts and asking the protocol and how they did things, he said, well, look, I've been doing it for 22 years, I just do it. I just know what to do. So what actually came out of it was quite interesting, and it has been adopted at the Mass General and also Cleveland Clinic, where they have a couple years of information about it. The idea, there were about 10 different recommendations, but the one that really made the most difference was kind of funny, because it wasn't a dramatic new instrument or something like that. What it was is looking at, yes, time is brain, but everybody's brain is different. So if you could add one more image on the arterial MRI when a patient comes into the hospital, into the emergency room, and see how much of the brain is still in good condition, then you know if you can help, if it's worth doing, extracting the clot through going up all the way from the groin and taking the clot or the blockage out. And so it really saved lives and saved money as well. And it's been adopted, it's slowly getting adopted different places. So that was a very different look at a medical problem. But then that's what convinced me that the systems approach was really worth following. We didn't know if it was going to work to have a systems approach. But then we decided that we'd look at a chronic illness. And at that time, childhood obesity was becoming an epidemic. So we again chose an architect from Columbia at the Earth Institute. And each time we've done a major project, we've found that if we look all across the country and see what's being done and what's good, maybe we'll learn from that and that can be spread or whatever. And one thing I mentioned to Georgia and Wen is every time we've done a project like that, looking first at what you might say the current state analysis, there's a lot of, there are a lot of good things going on, but the people doing them don't seem to connect. They may not even know about each other and may not have met each other. So I think there's the power of collaboration in getting them together, and they're really quite excited about interacting. And we found that in each of the projects we've done. We went from there to doing one with the military, and that time chose an engineer, because they are the engineers here? Ah, there you are, you know all about systems, right? Have you applied them to healthcare yet? Good. Yes, somebody here.
Can I just clarify? So the buildings that you wanted to build, are they like hospital type of place, or a research type of place, or a conversation type of place? Like, what do you mean by having a building in which you can house this kind of collaboration?
Okay.
So when you were saying that you were building, you are trying to come up with a plan of building to house the collaboration for healthcare. Do you mean like, is it like a hospital type of building? Or
no, no.
Building?
What we want to do is kind of spread the word. You're looking at something from the whole system, because if you fix one part, you still may have a broken system. And that's what, and when we do a project, we struggle very hard not to have a hypothesis, which seems very strange for medicine, where we always say, well, we think this, and we're going to test that to see if it's yes or no. So when I say building, I don't mean physical building. I mean encouraging people wherever they are, because now in the stroke project, yes, that's been adopted in hospitals. Childhood obesity, we're part of the Mrs. Obama's meetings and things like that, and there again, getting people together. And strangely, and I just thought, the one thing I don't want to hear is exercise more and eat less. You know, that's just years and years. I'm sick of it. But of course, that's what we heard. But at the same time, what we really found is that we were working on seeing how to make healthy food affordable and accessible. And it's a real, real problem. And when you consider that there may be a mother who's a single mother, who's working two jobs, who has a child in school, who doesn't live anywhere near a grocery store, and the child goes to school and hears that she should be eating fresh vegetables or this or that, and her mother, coming home from work, would have to get in a bus, walk to the grocery store, carry the stuff, get back, and then cook, and then get her child, and then get to another job. So it's unrealistic to think that it's an easy fix. And we really found that what needs to change is the food system. And so the thought is to work hard on having regional, national food systems, so it isn't that everything has to come from far. There, again, the local food, and this is happening. Not enough, but there's improvement. And yet, what are you doing in health? You.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. So right now, I work at the Brigham and Women's. I'm a computer scientist, and right now is that when you listen to patient heart sounds with a stethoscope, only one physician or whoever's on the healthcare surrounding staff can only listen to that time. So I'm building this app where it allows up to 100 folks, they can listen to the heart sound at once. So you don't have to be in the hospital, you can be elsewhere. Yeah, so the idea is it's an educational tool.
That's very good. And how do they follow your line?
Oh, I mean, it's just in the prototyping phase right now, yeah.
Well, that's just okay. You say just, I think that's, I mean, talk about something that's really useful. That's great.
Thank you.
Yeah. I know that there are apps that you can, it shows your own heart rate, but that's not really the point, you know?
True. Yeah.
And is Jenny?
Yes, my name is Jenny, yeah. J-Lo, yeah.
That's great. Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
And who are you collaborating with?
Well, so, so I want to talk about HST. They have this program for engineers to work with doctors.
Yes.
So Professor Edelman
He's one of our advisors on the current project we're doing.
Perfect. Yeah, he's been really innovative and supportive throughout this process. Yeah.
That's good. Well, I was mentioning the post-traumatic stress project we're doing with the military, and now our the project that we've just launched now is actually one that is looking at the process of clinical trials, mm-hmm. because it's just awful that patients aren't getting the medicines they need. I guess I don't need two of these, do I? Okay. The medicines they need in a timely manner, and they can be in a clinical trial, and then the trial is over, and they can't get the medicine, so.
Right, yeah. That's something I'm also interested in learning more about later on, if you have time, yeah.
So I'm just gonna write, tell LSI I saw you. Because he's an advisor to that project, and he was at a round table we did. We've had three round tables, mm-hmm. one here, one in New York, at Bloomberg Foundation, and one at at Holland and Knight, which is a law firm. And the former head of the FBI, who's also been an advisor to us, said, we have a wonderful new conference room. You have to come see it. And why don't you use it for one of your meetings? And it's such a wonderful new one that it's all glass, but if you want a private meeting and don't want people to look in, you press a button and mist comes up between the glass panels. I have to say, we should have tried it. So that's really interesting you're doing that. And it's kind of fun to think of. How many of you are doing collaborations within your own projects? And you may have heard just working with somebody else can be a collaboration. Yeah. Oh, yeah, tell us in the back, what are you doing?
So I work on, am I speaking loud enough? So I work on developing chemical sensors. Actually, a few people in this audience work with me.
Good.
But
collaboration right here.
What's that?
Collaboration right here.
Yeah. So you know, we work sort of at this intersection of there's molecular designs, there's synthesis, there's materials design, so polymers and nanotubes and all this, and then there's a lot of electrical engineering to get whatever signal you generate or don't generate on those, you know, functionalized systems into some sort of format like a smartphone or a portable device or whatever. So you have sort of a pretty broad spectrum of, you know, fundamental synthetic chemists working with people who have understandings of how to integrate this into, you know, fairly complex electronics. So.
And are some of those sensors?
Yeah, exactly. And so we look at both gas phase and increasingly looking at liquid phase sensing as well. So there's a pretty broad suite of applications.
The whole thing about wearable sensors and the things that are happening now, it seems to me, one of the big things I care about is prevention. And of course, it's the most unglamorous thing in medicine. Nobody cares about it. Besides, it doesn't happen tomorrow. And so it's just, and actually in some of the meetings we've done, the thing that really hits is, you know, it's prevention, not just in medicine, it's in healthcare, prevention in everything. You know, it applies to all sorts of things. So my hope is that I hear those of you who are doing the sensors and the apps and things like that. That, I think, is our biggest chance of getting to prevention.
Dr. Olver, as I'm listening to some of, like, a lot of people's different areas of study and hearing about the experiences that you've described in trying to solve trying to re-examine things like acute stroke, or obesity.
People said, it's already been done.
It's already been done. And there are people that have been maybe working on it for a long, long time, and you're able to make breakthroughs by bringing people together from atypical fields and often very different fields. So one of the things that I'm curious about, and I'm sure many other people in the room are curious about, is how do you get all of them to agree?
Well, you don't want them to.
Here's another way of asking. How do you get a bunch of people from different areas to come up with a solution? To work together.
First of all, we get them together. And if everybody in the room
can
agree that the sun is not set yet, then you've got to start. So if there's, and we purposely have people who have different or even contrasting interests, because if they can start talking about it and find some common interest, it's much easier to take the next step. And I don't remember anybody yelling yet in the meetings, but And I think one thing that, are there any architects in the room? One thing that architects say, and Marco Steinberg, who was a professor who was the lead in the research on the stroke project, he'd say, well, the first thing you have to do is say, do we know what we don't know? And then, do we really know what the problem is, or do we just think we know what the problem is? And then he talks about unpackaging it, how you have to unpackage the whole thing and then build it up. And that was kind of a new way of thinking for me. And when we first started using the systems approach, I didn't know if it was going to work. But it's been really quite interesting to see that. And even with a project in the military on post-traumatic stress, which happened at the time of the Walter Reed commissions. And actually, Norm Augustine, the former head of Lockheed Martin, who has written so many wonderful books about the gathering storm and education, he was an advisor on that stroke project, and he said, what you're doing has application to the military. So he put me in touch with Togo West, who was a former secretary of the Army, and he told Secretary Gates about it. And then, so we've been doing for a couple of years a project with the military. And there's one absolutely outstanding researcher, it's from the engineering department, from the engineering systems, and J.P.S. Srinivasan. And he just went in and he learned everything about the Army. He was looking strictly at the Army, the biggest service. And he learned the language, the acronyms, and I think in any collaboration you do, or any person who's an expert or not an expert but in a different field, there are different acronyms, acronyms can be the same but mean something completely different. In the military, it was in medicine, colodophilophiasis or idiopathic thrombocytopenia, that's just as difficult to
some of the tongue.
He really cared, and he has visited over 38 of the military health facilities across the country and overseas. And what it has done is help them really put behavioral health at a much higher level than it was. And they've made so many improvements that the Surgeon General of the Army gave him the highest civilian award that they have. So as we step into any of these things, it is learning. And some of the meetings that we've had, we thought, okay, we should really talk about log jams, because what are the things that need to be solved, and why aren't they being solved, and how do you get to them? Does the systems approach have any role there? And so it ended up, we didn't mean to stick with the log jam subject, but it sort of stuck with us. The first one was all about log jams, and we actually paired Admiral Mullen, who was the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, with the head of Doctors Without Borders, and it was quite interesting. They were talking about how they had managed to work together in Haiti and how it should have been able to be even faster. And then the next one we did was, do you have to have a crisis to solve a log jam? And then after that, again, we did one. We weren't going to use a log jam in the title again, but it was, can a log jam be a springboard for innovation? And so now, we talk about innovation.
Okay. Thanks to everyone for coming today. We're excited to have you here. My name is Georgia Lugatis, and I'm one of the COPSI co-chairs, the Committee on Scholarly Interactions. My other co-chair, Wen, will be coming in soon. He's just giving a lab presentation today, so I'm sad to not be here, but we'll be here soon. I'm excited. So we're excited today to have a guest speaker that will be talking, that will have a lecture, and she is going to make this interactive, so is looking to engage you guys and ask questions. So please feel free to ask as many questions you like. We'd like to make this a lively discussion. But first, to introduce Dr. Albert, I'd like to introduce Neil Shaw, who is an associate housemaster here at City Pacific. He's been here for about 1.5 years, and is also a member at Harvard School of Medicine.
All right. Okay, well, I'm really excited to have the privilege of introducing Dr. Albright for the last COSI lecture of this academic year, for a lot of reasons, but I mean, I think at MIT we're used to having people around with these as the most friendly towards women, but back then I can't even imagine. Powered through, chose the most difficult, a surgeon myself, as to this, one of the most difficult specialties. Was on the faculty at Harvard Medical School. And then over the course of her career, not only served many, many patients, but some of the most important and enduring institutions in our country sought her wisdom as a board member and as a chairwoman, from the National Library of Medicine to the White House Fellowship, the Whitehead Institute. Just learned about that one too. It's a long list. Then finally, although she got her formal education at Harvard, she found her way over to the better part of Cambridge more recently, and is now in charge of the MIT collaboration initiatives, where she helps bring systems-based approaches to deeply rooted social issues, including healthcare. So without further ado, one of the most inspiring people on earth, Dr. Kemi Albright. Say that Dr. Albright has an extraordinary record of achievement is probably an understatement, mostly because when you Google her, one of the first hits is a website called achievement.org. I'm sure you know about this, but there's a video where, you know, she talks about some of the extraordinary things that she's done, and it's on the side, it says, if you're interested in Dr. Albright, you may want to also watch the video with Jonas Salk, the inventor of the polio vaccine, or Francis Ford Coppola, like the greatest filmmaker of all time. So you're in good company, Dr. Albright. So there are many things that you could probably say about Dr. Albright, but she has many claims to fame. One of them is that she started skating at the age of 9. I understand that at some point early on in your skating career, you contracted polio, and then you couldn't use your legs. And as part of the recovery process, you sort of powered through, not only started skating again, but went on to win multiple Olympic medals for figure skating. Became the first American ever to win a gold medal in this sport in 1956. There's this great interview with you somewhere where you say that, oh, it's a Boston Globe, where you say that when you're growing up, you're the only person you knew named Kenley. And then, you know, in 1956, after she won the gold medal, there were all these Kenleys all of a sudden all over the world. And I think it was this summer, you threw a bash for all the Kenleys all over the world. That's how cool she is.
There were 66 of them.
There's 66 Kenleys from around the world who came. And there's a great picture in the Globe. So 1956, she retired from figure skating. So what do you do then? Well, you're Kenley Albright, you go to Harvard Medical School. And at the time, was one of very, very few women at the medical school. We were talking about how, of all of the medical professions, to this day, surgery still is not necessarily okay. If you're 66.
Well, it's so nice to be here. I've looked forward to it, and I'm so glad to see all of you. And one of the things that makes me really excited about being here is having experts in so many different fields all together at once is actually what MIT Collaborative Initiatives is all about, and is really why I started MIT Collaborative Initiatives. So it's quite an experience to see all of you here, and I find myself wanting to get to know each one of you and wanting to hear about what you do, and I guess we'd have to be very, very interactive to get all of that done, but I hope that I can ask you questions, and you can ask me questions too. And it is impressive to think that Georgia and Wynn are in charge of the scholarly things that go on here. And to see everybody here, knowing that you all have different backgrounds,